in the book of 1 Timothy, and we're talking about getting the most out of church. And in order to get the most out of church, you need to worship. And the question becomes, do I worship traditionally or contemporarily? How do we worship? And I got up here, worship, traditional, contemporary, or we just do it God's way? Now, my vote is for the last of these three choices, and so I want to talk a little bit about God's way of worship. In my Bible, I have right here on the front pew, in my Bible, when it comes to this passage, there's an editor's little note. I don't know, different Bibles are arranged different ways, but some have center reference columns, and some have summaries at the bottom. They got notes from scholars that try to clarify some of the ancient meanings into modern culture, and some of them, like mine, in front of every section, it has just a little line that's in italics to tell you it's not part of the text, but it summarizes what's following. And in my Bible, it says, instructions on worship. It's the Apostle Paul's telling Timothy, the young pastor at Ephesus, I have some instructions for you when it comes to worship. And I think that he's right on this. Although it's not part of the text where it says instruction on worship, I think he's right, and he's telling us these are instructions to worship. Now, we would think that if he was writing instructions for worship, what we would expect is that he would tell them about music. Isn't that what we think of when we think of worship? We're going to have a worship service. Well, there's going to be music. But it's not what you would expect. There's nothing in this passage that talks about music. Music helps us worship, but it's not worship in and of itself. Very interesting. Now, it's not that the Bible doesn't talk about worship. It does so in Colossians 3 and Ephesians. It also says the same thing. It says they sang psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, three different categories of music. It's not that they didn't have music, but this isn't what primarily made worship. It more or less prepares you for worship. All right? Now, I've been in ministry, and most of my ministry life, there's been this thing called worship wars. You know what I'm talking about? It's traditional music versus contemporary music. And the people who like the traditional music don't like the contemporary music. And the people who like the contemporary music said, hey, I don't like that other music. That's dead people music. All the writers are dead. Yeah. And so they got this conflict going. All my life, I faced this thing, you know. And can you imagine in Paul's day? Now, where he says, psalms, oh, some of you like the psalms. The psalms is the book of psalms in your Bible. If you split your Bible right to like the middle, right there, you got the book of psalms. It's the largest book in the Bible. There's 150 psalms. Some call it the Psalter. It's written originally in Hebrew, and they used to sing these in the church. Can you see the old timers? Say, wait a minute. What's this new stuff? You're introducing hymns into the church. We like the psalms, and don't you know that the psalms are inspired, and these hymns that you're bringing in, I don't know about that. I don't know if they're inspired by God. And the younger say, well, but we like the new hymns. And the older people say, but we like to do them in Hebrew. But I don't understand Hebrew. But we understand the language I'm singing in. You see what I say? You see the tension that went on? Time moves along. The Psalters drops out. I mean, we don't sing any of the psalms right out of the Bible, do we? Now, some churches still do. Do you realize that? But we don't. Along comes spiritual songs. I don't know, maybe it's third generation down. They come along and say, hey, we like this new style, this new music. We got these spiritual songs, and people sing, well, what's wrong with our hymns? I like the hymns. Why don't you guys go do your own thing, and we'll do our own thing? You see what I'm going? See what's going on? There's always been different kinds of music in the church. Always has, always will be. I don't even like the term contemporary. You know why? Because in 20 years, the next generation is going to say, that's old traditional stuff. You see what I'm saying? There's always been progress in the body of Christ. There was a time when we didn't have pianos. What did they play in church? You know, the Bible talks about a lyre, which is like a guitar. You know, it's a stringed instrument. There's strings on it. It's kind of like that, too. You see what I'm saying? Music in and of itself is amoral. There's no good or bad music. There is none. It's just sounds. The words can be immoral or moral, okay? You can say, I mean, turn on the radio and listen to somebody's station, that's pretty rank stuff. But it can also be really good stuff. But when it comes to worship, it's not about the music. It is not about the music. So what's it about? Well, if you want to worship God's way, you start with all sorts of prayers, all right? I urge you then, first of all, that requests, prayers, intercessions, thanksgiving be made for everyone. These are different categories of the same thing, of prayer. The general term to use is the second one in that list there, prayer. It encompasses everything. It just means you converse with God. We converse with God. Part of our worship is we converse with God. We talk to God. Tonight, we're going to spend a whole hour just conversing with God. Another part of that is requests. It's a request. I come to God and I say, Lord, I'm sick. Would you give me strength? Would you empower me? Would you give me good health? You make a request. Now, when it says request, you make requests, and that's why I sent you that card out. I can't pray for you if you don't make the request. I can converse with God. Remember in the Lord's Prayer, our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. That whole part there, you're just conversing with God. You're telling him he's holy. You're telling him you want his will to be done. You're just conversing. You haven't asked for a thing yet. You're adoring God. You see what I'm saying? You're just conversing with God. You're just talking with God. Later he says, give us this day our daily bread. Now he's asking for something. He's a request. You see what's going on here? The next part is intercession. And intercession means I'm not praying for something for myself. That's what we'll be doing a lot of this evening, interceding. We're going to take all the requests that we're given, and we're going to intercede. We're going to pray for other people's requests. I've already done that this morning with the blue cards. I prayed for other people's requests. That's intercession. And then there's thanksgiving. How many times do we ask God for something, and then he grants it, and we give him one thank you? I've been asking him like for weeks, you know, for the money for a new car. And then it's not a brand new one. It turns out to be like, it's just new to me, right? I've been praying for weeks, Lord, and then when it arrives, thank you, Lord. Thanksgiving is, I am thankful. I pour out my thanksgiving to God. We're going to do a time of thanksgiving tonight. We'll it's a little different way. You'll never have thanked him so much in your whole life if you come tonight. I guarantee it. All right? All sorts of prayer. This is where worship begins. It begins with prayers. And he then says, for the kings and all those in authority. We have a new president, Trump. Now, whether you voted for him or not, he's your president. And whether you're the one before him, you voted for him or not, he was your president. That's just the way it works. We're a republic. We're a democracy. And we are to pray for those in authority. So he says, kings and all those in authority. Do you realize who is in authority when Paul writes this? It was not a good emperor. Some of you might know his name, Nero. And do you remember what Nero did to the Christians? He lit them up as torches at his parties. All right? He says here, you pray not because it's the guy you like. You pray because it's the guy that God put on the throne. You see, God puts on and he takes down whom he wants to accomplish his greater purpose in time for all eternity. So we pray. We need to be praying for President Trump, Vice President Pence. We need to be praying for the cabinet. We need to be praying for our governor. We need to be praying for all in authority. We need to be praying for the police officer. We need to be praying for the public health official. We need to be praying for those who are in positions of authority. That's what the text says. All sorts of prayers. And so tonight we're going to pray for all kinds of things. Here's the purpose. That we may live peaceful. Peaceful and quiet lives. that we as a church might live in peace and be about our business in peace. You see, if we're not, if times are in turmoil, we cannot be as effective with our gospel witness to our community. But when times are peaceful, then we can't penetrate our culture. And finally, he says, in all godliness and holiness. So I've given to everyone, I put in a bulletin, all right, this little prayer card, we need you to fill it out. If you haven't done so already, put it in your offering plate. On the way out, you can just give it to me. I'm going to pull these all together, and we're going to pray for all your prayer requests tonight. So I want you to do that. Even if you haven't already done it, you can do it right now. Just pull that thing out. I don't care. Start writing during the message. That's right. Tune out for a little while. Put down your prayer requests and pray so we can pray. Now, the second thing I notice is that if we're going to really worship, we have to have seeker-sensitive services. This is good, he says, and pleases God our Savior, who wants all men to be saved. Wants all men to be saved. Maybe you know somebody who doesn't know Jesus as their Savior. You want them to come to know Jesus as your Savior? Guess what? God wants them to know Jesus as their Savior too. You want to pray the will of God? You pray that they come to know Jesus as their Savior too. You want to put that on your card? You know somebody that doesn't know Jesus? You write that name on that card. We're going to pray tonight. We're going to pray for that person that they come to know Jesus as their Savior too. God wants all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. So we need to have a service that is sensitive to people who would come in that we don't know, so that the gospel is present so they can learn how to become a Christian. That should be part of what we do. We're sensitive to people who don't know Jesus as their Savior, and we want to bring them to know Jesus as their Savior. Worship is sensitive to other people and where they're at. One of the evangelism strategies I've read recently was, it's called prayer evangelism. You just go to your neighbor you don't know, or you knock on the door and you say, hey, listen, I'm from church, and we're doing this thing at church called prayer evangelism, and we're praying for our neighbor's request. Anything you want me to pray for, I will pray for it. Just share whatever you want, and I'll pray for that. And they give you what their prayer request is, and you leave. You don't do anything more than that. How hard is that? You ask somebody, can I pray for you? Then you go back and you pray for that, and you pray for that, and you pray for that. And about 2 weeks later, you go back, you knock on the door and say, hey, I've been praying for the last 2 weeks. Has God answered my prayer yet? Wow. And they say, they're blown away. Somebody cares about me enough to pray for my request for 2 weeks. You see, this is sensitivity to other people. And real worship, you see, is being sensitive like God is. He wants other people to come to faith. And I get sensitive to other people. I start praying for them. And the person says, well, no, God hasn't answered. Or he said, yeah, he has. And you say, well, is there something else I can pray for? And you go and you pray for that. Or you say, I'll be back. He hasn't answered. I'll be praying. I'll be back in a couple weeks and pray. And you go and you pray for 2 weeks. You go back, you knock on their door, and you say, hey, has God answered my prayer yet? And you know what happens when God answers your prayer? They say, I don't know what you got, but I want it too. You see what I'm saying? It's not so hard to share our faith. And real worship is sharing our faith, being sensitive to other people who are seekers. They don't know they're seeker, but they are. They're all searching for something. They just don't know that it's Jesus. And real worship, we present Jesus to them. Real worship, there's a real God connection. My heart's desire every week, and I pray that, you know, God would remove your distractions from your mind, your focus, and that God would connect with you, connect with me from the Word, that something out of it would just jump off the page, and it would speak to my heart, and I'd carry that away with me. It says there is one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. In the Sistine Chapel in Italy, you know, in Rome, is the painting on the ceiling that Michelangelo painted years ago. We were there, we saw it. You know, you stand like this looking up because it's directly in the center on the ceiling. I've added a little bit to Michelangelo's painting. You probably didn't notice that. But he painted God, the creation of man, and it just, you know, poof, you know, God's so powerful. But there's a chasm between them. Did you notice that? Because of the fall, there's a chasm between me and God. And there is only one way to God, and that is through Jesus Christ. So I put the cross there to show that the chasm is bridged. We connect with God only through the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Peter was preaching, said, there is no other name under heaven given to men whereby men must be saved. There's no other name. Here he says, there's one mediator, one go-between. You cannot connect with God without connecting with Jesus. And that's why we preach Jesus. There's one mediator between God and men, the man, Christ Jesus. The focus of church is about Jesus Christ, our Savior, our Lord, who gave himself a ransom for all. You and I, we were held hostage. We were born hostages. The hostage is our sin. We're a hostage, and the wages of sin is death, and Jesus paid the ransom. The price to set us free is we got to die. And Jesus dies in our place. He is the one who ransomed us. And I worship him because he paid the price for me to set me free, to ransom me from my enslavement and my being a hostage to sin. The next one here is we worship with timely testimonies. Timely testimony. He goes and said, the testimony given in its proper time. There is a proper time to testify. And a wise man knows when to speak up and when not to speak up. There are inappropriate times to blurt out your testimony. God, at the right time, sent forth his son to be a testimony to who he was. Not too early, not too late. I likewise need to give my testimony. Here I got this guy. You know the story. Jesus is walking along with the disciples. There's a man born blind. He's 38 years been blind. And the disciples say, hey, who sinned, this guy or his parents that he's born blind? And Jesus says to them, neither one. He was born that way to show the work of God. He spits on the ground. He mixes the dirt with his spit. Picks up a little bit. Plasters it on the guy's eyes. That's some unusual solve. When was the last time you went to the eye doctor and he put dirt in your eye? He says to him, go to the pool called Siloam, which means sent. And he says, go there and wash. And so he goes and he washes. And then people noticed it and said, wait a minute. Aren't you the guy that was blind? He said, yeah, there was this man, Jesus. He came by, spit, put it on my eyes. And then he told me to go wash. And I can see. And then they took him to the Pharisees. Pharisees say, how did this happen? He tells the story all over again. And they say, oh, no, this guy is a sinner. He said, well, I don't know if he's a sinner or not. This is one thing I do know. I once was blind, but now I see. Testimony. That's testimony. He's testifying. And then they ask, they bring his parents in. You read the passage, he testifies four times. And at the end, he meets Jesus. Their paths cross again, and he meets Jesus. And Jesus said, do you believe in the Son of God? He said, I don't know who he is to believe. And he said, I who am speaking to you am he. And he fell down and he worshipped him. He worshipped him. He worshipped him. You see, we worship through our testimony of what God has done in our lives. And we tell people about what he's done in our lives. And I can get together at a testimony service and say, this is what God has done in my life. And when we share what God has done in our life, that's worship. We worship God. We're worshiping God. Because worship is nothing more than bragging about God. Praise is just bragging about God. If I brag about myself, I'm boastful. If I brag about others, I'm building them up. I'm edifying. But when I brag about God, I'm praising him. I'm worshiping. I'm worshiping God. The next one is preaching and teaching the truth. That's how we worship. And for this purpose, I was appointed a herald. Now, a herald is somebody who yells and cries out. And I have a tendency to raise my voice. Did you notice? If I get excited, I tend to raise my voice. Well, that's what a preacher does. He raises his voice. You say, when I see you're nodding off, I'll raise my voice, wake you up. He raises his voice because he wants to be heard. He's a herald, he's a preacher, and an apostle, one sent from God. And I'm telling you the truth, I'm not lying. And a teacher of the truth. Jesus said, thy word is truth. So why my message is, I try to put all the scriptures up there on the screen, because the power of God unto salvation is not my stories, it's not any quips. Right here is the power of God unto salvation. It is the word of God. And so I put it up there so you can see what the word of God says, because it is the power. I want to teach. I want you to go away knowing something, not what I do or what I think, but what God has said in his word. This has been the central part of worship in the evangelical church ever since there's been one. It's the preaching of the word. So I, and the old churches, you know, the pulpits were usually lifted up high because it was the high point, okay? It's the high point. You lift up your eyes because this is the central focus, the preaching of the Word of God. Through the preaching of the Word of God, people come to know Jesus and they live for Jesus. Preaching and teaching is worship. You're worshiping by engaging in the preaching of the Word. Then there's more prayer. More prayer. I want men, he focuses on men here. I want men everywhere to lift up holy hands in prayer. He starts with prayer and he comes back. He says, without anger or disputing. Yes, you know, some of our prayers are a little angry. God, why did you? Did you ever have that prayer? Why did you let this happen? Why don't you do this? Are we a little instructive, a guy? You know, no, get rid of all that. He says, just lift up, men everywhere, lift up your hands in a conversation with God. The conversation of God. Turn the corner here. Now he's going to speak a little bit more to the women. I also want women to dress modestly. Dress modestly. With decency and propriety. Not with braided hair or gold or pearls or expensive clothes. But with good deeds. Appropriate for women who profess to worship. Years ago I was doing door-to-door. You know, going door-to-door. Back when that was a little more acceptable thing. I was going door to door, sharing my faith. Come to a family and they invite me in. I share my faith with them. They accept Jesus as Savior. And the woman says, oh man, this is a great day, but I can't come to your church. I said, what? Why can't you come to our church? She said, oh, I drive by. I said, our church was on a main road. And yet, she said, I've been by the church going back and forth to work, and I noticed all the women there wear dresses, and I don't own a dress. I said, what? She said, oh, no, I work in a factory. I straddle on a machine. I wear blue jeans. I wear blue jeans everywhere. I said, okay, well, we can fix this two ways. I said, I'll either go back and tell the women start wearing blue jeans, or I'll go buy you a dress. Which would you like? And so we did. We asked people, hey, you know, it's not how fancy we look. He wants us to dress modestly, not immodestly. But it is not a fashion show. It's not to say that we don't pay attention to ourselves and make ourselves look good. Of course we do. In fact, the Old Testament, you had to worship in holy attire. He wants you to look good. He wants you to present yourself the best. But it's not about the outside. That's what he's trying to get at. Worship is about what's going on the inside. The modesty. Not that I'm flashy, but that people take notice of me. But really, I dress modest that they don't, but I look good. And I come before God because worship is not about me. Worship is about Him. And my coming before Him and laying myself humbly before Him, I do what is appropriate for those who profess to worship God. You come with a learning attitude. He says, a woman should learn in quietness and full submission. I think Paul is writing to Timothy because there's a problem in the church. There are some women who are not learned, they don't know what they're talking about when it comes to the scriptures, and they're trying to take leadership positions. And he's saying here, a woman should learn in quietness and in full submission. I do not permit a woman to teach. If she's unlearned, I don't want that woman teaching and to have authority. If she's unsubmissive, I don't want her to have authority. So listen, there's got to be some order in the church. He says, you come with a learning attitude. I think it's not just women. I think everybody needs to come with a learning attitude. I don't know at all. I remember when I finished, first time I read through the whole Bible. Those of you who are reading through the Bible, you start Exodus today. And then you're in Matthew chapter 15. If you've fallen behind, just jump into where you should be and keep going. Just keep going, all right? But I remember the first time I read through the whole Bible, I thought I knew it all. Until I read it the second time and said, well, how come I didn't see that the last time? Well, I didn't see that. It was like, oh my goodness, all right? It took me down a notch because I didn't know it all. Every time I read the Bible, I realize, hey, you know what I did one year? I listened my way through the Bible. I put the CDs in my car every time I drive. I listened to the Bible, and I listened all the way through the Bible, and I realized he would be reading. I said, no way, that can't be in there. I've read my Bible several times. I go back, look it up, sure enough. But the way he enunciated and read that, it just jumped out, was different to me. He says, listen, you need to have a learning attitude that you don't know it all. None of us. She must be silent, he says. Here he gives a biblical explanation of what he's talking about here. Now, you got to assume that Timothy knows the scriptures. He does. He's been taught them by his mother and his grandmother. He knows the scriptures, and he's going to give him a biblical example of what he's talking about. He says, first of all, he says from creation, for Adam was formed first, then Eve. There she is. Adam was formed first, then Eve. When God created Adam first, he gave Adam some simple instructions. He said, you can eat of everything that's in the garden, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, you cannot eat of it, for in the day you eat of it, you shall surely die. He told that only to Adam. Nobody else had heard that. Then he created Eve. So Eve doesn't know this. So when you come to the third chapter, along comes the tempter, and the tempter says, oh, hey, has God said that you can't eat of all the trees of the garden? And she says, oh, God has said, you can't eat of it, you can't even touch it, lest she adds just a little bit there. Well, where did she get this information from? God hadn't told her. God told Adam. Who did Adam tell? He told Eve. Did she listen to what he said? Yeah, she even added to it. She didn't listen correctly. You see, this passage is all about, do you have a learning attitude? Adam was not deceived by the tempter when he came. The tempter then says, oh, no, no, God does not have your best interest in view. If he knows that the day you eat of it, you're going to be just like him. You'll know good and evil like God knows good and evil. And so God's holding out on you. You see, false teaching, false teaching. She was the one deceived. That's what I said. Adam was not deceived. It was the woman who was deceived and became a sinner. I find this very interesting. She's deceived, became a sinner. So she's the first sinner, right? But the Bible in Romans chapter 5 says, wherefore is by one man sin entered into the world. Why is Adam accountable for sin and the woman is not accountable for that first sin that brings the consequences of sin upon all men? And it's very simple. She was deceived. She was tricked. She was duped. He voluntarily chose to disobey God. He voluntarily rebelled. There was no deception, no trickery, no deceit here. He just took of that fruit and he ate it. She was deceived because she followed false instruction. She was unlearned in the original command and what was going on here. That's what's tying in here. He says there's the fall. Now, in that passage, it goes on to say, but the women will be saved through childbearing. So some people think every woman who has a baby must be saved. But you got to put it back into context. He's talking about the fall. He's talking about creation, fall, and now he's talking about salvation. In the midst of the curse, there's a curse because of the fall, a curse upon the serpent. He says, you're going to crawl on your belly all the days of your life. And then he goes on in that passage, and he said, I'm going to put enmity, I'm going to put animosity, I'm going to put a war between the woman and the serpent, between his seed, the serpent, and the woman's seed, uh-oh, got a problem here. Women don't have seed, they have eggs. What's going on here? This is called the proto-evangelium in Genesis 3:15. The first gospel. The first gospel. That the woman is going to have a child without the man's seed, her seed, seed implanted by the Holy Spirit, and there's going to be a virgin birth. There's going to be a sinless one because sin is passed on by Adam to his descendants. There's going to be a sinless Savior who is going to save the world from its sin. He goes on to say in that passage that the serpent is going to be like a snake that when a man's walking down the path, strikes out and gets the man by the heel. And then what the man does is he turns right around and he stomps on the head of the serpent and crushes it. He's struck and he's been bit by the serpent, but the serpent has been totally crushed and killed by the woman's seed. Down through time, commentators have all said, this is the first reference to the Messiah. Satan may do all that he can to destroy the Messiah. From Herod trying to destroy him as a two-year-old to having him nailed on the cross. But when Jesus rose from the dead, he crushed Satan's head. He's just waiting for his final doom when he's cast into the lake of fire forever and ever. What we have here, but women will be saved through childbearing if they continue in faith. You see, down through the ages, before Mary came, every woman thought, maybe I will have the Messiah, the Savior. Women are saved through childbearing because women, a woman, bears the Savior. And if you believe in him and you continue in faith in him, in love in him, and holiness with propriety, you're genuine, sincere about this, you will experience the salvation of the Lord. Here's the point of what I'm trying to say this morning. Worship is much more than traditional and contemporary music. It's so much more. What is it? It's praying. It's evangelizing. It's connecting with God. It's testifying. It's preaching and teaching. It's doing good deeds. It's learning. It's explaining God's word correctly. There's so much more to worship than a song. Than a song. I got a perfect application for my message today. I don't always say they're perfect, but I know this one's perfect. All right, this one's perfect. Join us tonight at 6 o'clock for all kinds of prayers. All kinds of prayers. As I said, you can participate or you can spectate because we're going to pray. You could just be an observer and say, you know, I really don't know how to pray. Well, just come watch. We're going to pray. Pray, pray, pray. And storm the gates of heaven and truly worship the true and living God. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we've just gone through these instructions for worship. We want to worship you. We want you to be first, foremost in our lives. And worship isn't just a one-hour thing. We see that. It's going to be when we leave here. We can worship at home when we read the word. We can worship with our neighbors when we share our faith. We can worship. Lord, worship is so much more than just a song. Help us, O Lord, to be a people that truly worship the true and living God. For this I pray, in Jesus' name, amen.